Bold knaves thrive without one grain of sense, but good men starve for want of impudence. Those lines are from John Dryden, poet of the Restoration, a name given to the period that encompasses the reign of Charles II of England, Scotland, and Ireland, who was invited to take up the throne of a reinstated monarchy at the behest of the Parliament, who despaired at the incompetence of Oliver Cromwell's son and successor, Richard, known as Tumbledown Dick. Cromwell had indeed been bold, and, during war at least, thrived, but was highly unpopular during his protectorate. Charles II, by contrast, was held in great esteem initially, and became known as the Merry Monarch. He inherited the political prudence of his grandfather, James VI and I, but ultimately squandered his political capital by refusing to press for reforms. The tensions of the 1640s, albeit in less violent forms, went unresolved, and his successor, James VII and II, was driven from the country by William of Orange in 1688, during the Glorious Revolution. The execution of Charles I in 1649 was widely unpopular, and people's instincts were confirmed by contemporary royalist propaganda. It was, however, seen as a necessary act, and not an arbitrary assassination. Charles was not someone to do business with. When Charles II was crowned king in 1660, many were optimistic that this would welcome a new era in which divisions might be healed, and those who had fought against his father accepted Charles II's offer of amnesty. There was certainly a desire for revenge against the Puritans, but this was restrained, and of the 31 signatories to Charles I's death sentence still alive, only 11 were executed. In fact, the new so-called Cavalier Parliament was more royalist than the monarch, and they sought to narrow the Church of England to the detriment of non-conformers against Charles II's will for toleration. At this time, there was no professional police force, and so the authorities relied on informers, who, in return for their denunciations, were offered a third of the fines issued. This massively incentivized denouncing groups such as Quakers and Unitarians for illegal assembly. Persecution of Presbyterians was massively ramped up in the 1680s, and later became known as the Killing Time in Scotland, for Charles II's government forced the Kirk to renounce Presbyterianism in favour of bishops appointed by the king. Judicial torture was commonplace, and thumbscrews were used to obtain information about conspiracies. Nevertheless, there was a cult of monarchy in England, and Charles communicated with his subjects through the pulpit, requiring Anglican clergy to read out his decrees. There was even a revival, coinciding with Louis XIV in France, of the King's Touch, said to cure scrofula. Charles's failure to take his parliament seriously and negligence of people's concerns eventually led to an atmosphere of paranoia and accusations of conspiracy with the Pope. The king had many mistresses and fathered at least 13 illegitimate children, who took the name Fitzroy, meaning son of the king, but he failed to produce a valid heir. Oliver Cromwell's main policy, when he had defeated the Scottish and Irish rebels, was to keep order and maintain control while ensuring that demands for radical reform were not allowed to threaten the stability of the Commonwealth he had established. The main threat to his power was conspiracy growing up around the future Charles II, who was in French exile. By contrast, when Charles II was in power, he took a hands-off approach and let his Cavalier Parliament take care of domestic affairs and religious policy. He failed to realise, however, that the main threat to his dynasty was from within, among the religious nonconformist minority alienated by the Test Act of 1673. Requiring Church of England membership to hold public office, vote, attend university, and legally preach. Charles's Parliament agreed to provide enough revenue to run the kingdom and support the king financially. It didn't, and Charles turned to France for help. Because Charles held sway over foreign policy, he negotiated a treaty with Louis XIV, in which he agreed to support war against the Dutch for money. Charles also signed the Secret Treaty of Dover in 1670, in which he agreed to convert to Catholicism at the opportune moment and gradually return England to Rome in exchange for a £230,000 annual pension. 15 years later, he suffered a stroke, and in February 1685, he became a Catholic on his deathbed. His brother, James VII and II, who was openly Roman Catholic, succeeded him, and in 1688, when he sired a male heir, a cross-party group of Tory and Whig MPs, known as the Immortal Seven, invited William of Orange, Stadtholder of the Dutch Republic, and his wife, Mary Stuart, to oust him from the throne in what is known as the Glorious Revolution. William of Orange was not a monarch before he became King of England, Scotland and Ireland. He governed the Dutch Republic as Stadtholder, which is equivalent to Cromwell's status as Lord Protector several decades previously. He was married to James VII and II's daughter, Mary, granting him a modicum of legitimacy. The main thing about William, though, was his reputation as a staunch defender of Protestantism. Both Tories and Whigs, emergent political factions at the time, agreed that Catholics should be excluded from the throne. They therefore invited William to intervene with his Dutch troops, which, at least in England, were met with little opposition, and the Glorious Revolution is sometimes referred to as a bloodless coup, partly due to the self-engineered propaganda machine preparing the ground for William's landing. One of the most significant pieces of legislation to come out of the revolution was the Bill of Rights in 1689, which set down that a monarch must hear their subjects, is subject to law, and cannot arbitrarily suspend law. In Ireland, William is remembered for the Battle of the Boyne and the Siege of Derry, which cumulatively ushered in Protestant political ascendancy and the deep divisions of the 18th century and beyond. The notion that the Bill of Rights led to widespread liberty is largely retroactively imposed. Some have claimed that it helped Britain to avoid a radical French Revolution. More importantly, however, the 1690s were an age of financial revolution, seeing the Bank of England's establishment in 1694 out of a consortium of London and Edinburgh merchants.